विद सो मेनी मीटिंग्स एंड ऑल यू हैव टाइम टू गो ऑन फेसबुक एंड स्टफ।
क्या करेंगे, अरे दूसरा कोई काम ही
इलेक्शन
तो नहीं है कि
इलेक्शन लड़ रहा है भैया, तेरे मेरे को
नहीं
थोड़ी
नहीं
इलेक्शन लड़नी है।
अरे नहीं ऐसा तो नहीं है, अरे दूसरा कुछ काम क्या है, बोल क्या
नहीं,
करेगा,
काम भी नहीं है बराबर, दूसरा काम
सही
नहीं
है
रहेगा तो क्या करेगा। अभी
क्या
अपन भी
करेगा,
वेबिनार कर रहे, काम धंधा ही नहीं कुछ।
सही बात सब
कुछ
कुछ।
ऐसा। अरे दिन में तो घर से सुबह अगर 8 बजे हम लोग निकलते थे, रात को 10:30-11 बजे
कैसा
निकलते थे।
रोशन, तुमने तो कितने लोगों को डिप्रेशन में जाने से बचाया है इसको लाइव रख के।
बराबर है ना, सिर्फ
ये एक दूसरे से बात तो करवाया सबको रोशन
एग्जैक्टली
भाई।
एग्जैक्टली
कितना मजा आ रहा है अपना, सोचो। तो आई थिंक वी हैव डॉक्टर तन्मय चौधरी नहीं ज्वाइन किया अभी तक, डॉक्टर अभय नार्वेकर इज ज्वाइनिंग इन सम टाइम, रघुवीर इज प्रोबेबली वॉकिंग समवेयर। रघुवीर, सो विनय पांडे, विनय इज देयर, यस विनय
ज्वाइन कर लिया, यस
कुलदीप, यस रघुवीर रेड्डी इज देयर, सोनेन्दु इज देयर, विक्रम शर्मा इज ज्वाइनिंग इन 10 मिनट्स, जया प्रसाद नहीं ज्वाइन किया अभी तक, सिद्धार्थ अग्रवाल इज देयर, एंड गोपीनाथ विल नॉट बी एबल टू ज्वाइन, एंड अंटाव सर इज ज्वाइनिंग इन अनदर 15 मिनट्स।
तो का
अनिल
बॉस ज्वाइन
अनिल
किया, उसका नाम लिया संदीप का, बॉस
अनिल
बॉस जो ज्वाइन
हाँ
कर लिया
गया
ना।
सर, आ गया आ गया। पिंपरीकर इज
हाँ
ज्वाइनिंग अस, अनिल पाटिल इज ऑलरेडी देयर, अनिल कैन यू, अनिल इज देयर, नागराज शेट्टी इज नॉट गोइंग टू ज्वाइन टुडे, संजय त्रिवेदी, संजय त्रिवेदी इज देयर, निकोलस अंटाव, रोशन वाड़े, संदीप बिराई, प्रदीप निमाड़े। आई थिंक वी विल स्टार्ट द मीटिंग, आई विल हैंड ओवर द पोडियम टू डॉक्टर अनिल पाटिल एंड डॉक्टर संजय त्रिवेदी। संजय भाई यू हैव द प्रोग्राम, अनिल पाटिल यू हैव अ प्रोग्राम, प्लीज स्टार्ट द मॉडरेशन ऑफ द प्रोग्राम। First speaker is Dr. Swarnendu, who is going to speak on SCL with LAT.
Okay.
Can I go to slides here?
Yeah.
Yes,
we are live on YouTube, please.
Okay, we
Sanjay
are
bhai.
Live. Okay.
Yeah. So I invite our Dr. Swarnendu Samanta for the presentation on ACL with LAT. Please share your screen.
Well, you have to enable me for slides here. Somebody has to disable me.
No, kiya.
Abhi kiya.
Everybody can share now. Yes.
Yes.
Sandeep is just there. By look of his face, you can know.
Sandeep, I thought darne ka hai.
Okay.
So is it coming?
Yes,
yeah,
we can
yeah.
see you. Go ahead.
I'll just mute everyone. Swarnendu,
yes,
just
go ahead.
1 minute. Yes, Anindu, you can go ahead.
Okay. So I am audible, Roshan?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. It's okay, no problem. So but today basically we are going to discuss about some parts, right, is only whether the whenever we do only ACL, whether that is going to serve our purpose, yes or no. Because sometimes we don't understand what has happened to the periphery. Because ACL is a more or less a central structure, and nowadays we talk of like the knee is not just like a joint, it is like an organ. Okay, so whenever there is ACL tear inside, please test all the corners and all the collaterals, because if you miss your collateral injury or your corner injury, whatever the best way you do the ACL, or if you choose the BTB, quadriceps tendon, hamstring, whatever graft you choose, it is going to fail. It is more true if the guy is young. Suppose this guy is 20-25 years, explosive pivot, it might be second degree pivot, and young soccer player, then what is the choice? So dilemma is which graft is the best one, and whether to add LET or not, and when to add it. Because if you go into the literature and textbooks, even the re-rupture in ACL recons is more or less like 25%. And we all agree that whatever the best possible way you do your ACR, LR, your return to the play to that same level is around 60 to 70%. So believe that one third of your patients are never going to join the same sports again. So why this is so? Because pivot shift is not only the anterior translation. It is there are two complex problems are there. One is the anterior translation, and also there is internal rotation of the tibia. So ACL is not the only structure to restrict the internal rotation. That you have to take. So this is the Rob Laprade's paper in 2019 in Arthroscopy Association of North America journal, that persistent anterolateral rotator instability after ACLR is probably due to the damage to the lateral structures, damage to the posterolateral corner, meniscal injury might be the ramp or the root, damage to the anterolateral structures, and also the inherent tibial slope. So you all been seeing these sort of pictures in Laprade's article, and also we have seen these papers from the Freddy Fu, and many authors are writing on the anterolateral structures. But this is not the very new concept. So whenever this ACL is happening, ACL injury is happening, the young people and the high grade pivot is there, and they have to return to the pivoting sport, you have to be over cautious, because you know that excessive tibial rotation during high demand activities is not restored by ACL reconstruction. So in the late 90s, like 1897, Paul Ferdinand Sigon told us that what is Sigon's fracture. And whenever the basically Sigon fracture is like a telltale sign of your ACL injury. Even Henri Cotet told us that if you just cut the ALL in an ACL deficient knee, the rotation is increased by 6 degrees. So you have to believe that something is on the lateral side, which is preventing that internal rotation. Even that landmark paper by Stephen Claes in 2013 in the Anatomy Journal, that he told about the anterolateral ligament complex. So this is the picture from Freddy Fu's article, and this is dotted line. You can, if you can see, just below the IT band, this structure is the anterolateral ligament complex. And sometimes when we see the acute ACL injury, and if you can see the MRI very carefully, next time onwards, please look at the region where the Kaplan fibers are there. So if you see that there, and you see the what is written in the red underlined way, the deep capsular ligament osseous layer of the ITB in 93% of the functionally unstable knees, they can be reconstructed. And this damage correlated significantly with the higher grade of pivot shift. So please remember that ACL is not only the structures which is probably going for the high grade pivot or the, even the explosive pivot. And Ellison in 1978 told us that if you want to control the rotation, like your steering wheel, if you, when you drive, you don't hold at the center of the wheel, you hold at the periphery. So if you don't look at the periphery of your knee, probably you cannot control your rotation. So there are a lot many methods, like when we started doing, like we read like 1967 from the article of your, from the French paper, Lemaire. When he did for the high athletes, like your Lemaire procedure, which was later modified. Okay, so there are a lot many methods now, like the Ellison method and all the your McIntosh method is there. So if you read the article by the N.J. Breston article, which is also the colleague of Rob Laprade, and the, if you add the LET, reduce the stress on the ACL graft by 43%. So if you add on your LET, if you read this line carefully from the that paper, this, if you add the LET, the stress on the ACL is reduced by 43%. And if you read this Hunty group study, the significantly reduced when you add 2 years, if you add on the anterolateral ligament reconstruction, you add on the ACL graft, which is the minimum follow-up is 2 years. Even you see, whenever you do your hamstring tendon along with the anterolateral ligament, you will be hardly, you are not believe unless you read this article, that the combined hamstring and ALL reconstruction with a hazard ratio of 2.5 times less than the isolated bone tendon. So those who say that bone tendon is much, much better to do the, all the, it can negate the pivot even in the high grade athletes, that is not the true story. So repeat operation or graft failure is as low as 2.6% when you add on the ALL. Even this is from the Santi group study. And people tell that if you add on the LET, probably you are going to overstress the your lateral compartment. But if you read the Ferretti's article, which is probably having the more 10 years study, that is a study was taken for 25 years, but the minimum study was for 10 years, there was no lateral compartment osteoarthritis, even the posterior of the patellofemoral joint. Now come to the stability study by the Alan Gatgood. Now, if you do the ALL, ACL reconstruction only, then probably your re-injury is around 11%. But if you add on the ACL with the LET, it is like 4%. So you have to believe that something is done if you do add on the LET. So adding the LET procedure resulted in 65% relative risk reduction for graft failure from that Gatgood paper. So this is a very complex graph. Don't look at the whole graph. Just remember that this graph, this line is your intact ACL. And this is the flexor angle. This is the change of anterior translation. So this is the anterior translation at 40 to 50 degree where the ACL is intact. But this line, this dotted line is the when the ACL is cut. Okay. So if you just see that if the deep ITB, ALL, everything is cut, it goes around at the top of the graph. So the, if you cut everything, it will be loose anterior translation. But if you just add a mono loop on the lateral side, it comes very close to the intact ACL. Even if you see the internal rotation, if you cut the deep ITB, ALL and ACL, this is highest. Okay. But if you just add on the mono loop on the lateral side, it comes close to the intact ACL. So anterolateral ligament complex is very, very important for controlling your pivoting activities. Even if you read the article by Njebast and Adai, I told you, if you add on the ALL, it is going to reduce the graft stress by 43%. So now we know where to add on the ADLs. It is just the proximal and posterior to your fibular attachment, the lateral epicondyle. So because when you deal with the high grade athlete, you have to pass all the tests like single hop, X hop, triple hop, and the timed hop. And also you have to pass on not only those four things, but you have to go with the T test, the arrow test, and also the Illinois. So if, to pass this all these tests, seven tests, you have to have not only the AP laxity, but you have to have no pivot at all. So playing sports after ACL injury, if the guy is young, less than 25 years, if he is having second or third degree or the explosive pivot, and he has to return to the pivoting sports, you have to do something on not only the ACL. So ACL believe that ACL tears do not occur in isolation. Strength-wise, even if you see the hamstrings are more or less two times more than your intact ACL. Stiffness is also cross-sectional, is also the hamstrings. So the even the if you do the hamstring, you don't lose the extension. Return to sports at the end of 2 years is more or less same if you do both the VTB and the hamstring. So nowadays, the pendulum is swinging towards the hamstring. And go with if you this is the Alan Gatgood article which won the 2019 ISACOS meeting the Gilchrist Award, and also that article won the O'Donoghue Award for this article, the stability group. So ultimately, this is the last line of the Alan Gatgood's paper. Ultimately, we hope to enable patients in getting back to the activities they love most. So I think if you do the high level athlete, the young guy pivoting sports, there is no harm. It is rather more rewarding to add on a lateral LET on the lateral side. If you do that, you expect that you will not only negate the AP laxity, also you will restrict the pivoting thing. So that is the best way of doing your high grade pivot for your soccer players. Thank you very much for your kind and patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Samantha. It was very clean cut message in your presentation. Anybody has any questions?
Yeah, Dada. Samantha Dada, Atik. Can you hear me? Hello, sir.
Suddenly, question from Dr. Atik.
Samantha Dada, can you hear me?
Yes, Rav, I can hear you. Something, I think somebody's internet is not very strong, but still we'll continue. No problem. Okay.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah, supposing for the sake of this, I'm also predominantly a hamstring guy in LET, but just for the sake of discussion, I want to ask you something. Supposing you have a 20-year-old guy, not a professional, plays football and has a grade 2 pivot with an ACL. Would you, in those circumstances, consider doing only a BTB?
No. The question is that whether the proponents of doing the BTB, they tell that the graft is much stronger than the forced and hamstring that will negate your pivoting thing. But believe me, that is not this true story. Even if you do the BTB, you cannot tell that this pivot will go because there
are papers to suggest that around a grade 2 pivot, the BTB also takes control of some amount of rotation also.
No, that is not true. Even if you read the Freddy Fu's article and now why the people are now going back again from the double bundle to the single bundle, they tell if you just do the AM bundle, then probably you can negate the pivot shift. Not only the double bundle will do, but if the lateral structures is torn, then even by doing the bone tendon, you cannot negate the pivot shift.
I'm talking about grade 3.
If the guy is a football player, he has to go to the pivoting and cutting sports. Not you cannot negate only by doing the bone tendon bone. Even with the bone tendon bone, you have to add the LED.
Okay.
The bone tendon bone is probably to early healing and let them get back to the sports early. That is the advantage, and in current context, otherwise hamstring has always been equivalent or
the healing does not happen in the tunnels, no?
Bone plugs heal in the tunnel, no? For bone patellar tendon bone. For hamstring healing happens on the mouth, but for bone patellar tendon bone healing happens in the bone plug. In four months time, the Europeans in 4 months time they get back on the ground. That is what they say.
My question was somewhat related to that only, that whether you can get them back, grade 2, just to a single procedure.
I will come to both Atik's point and also the Sanjay's point that the healing in bone tendon bone is 4 weeks earlier than the hamstring. It is 6 to 8 weeks in bone tendon bone, they claim. And the hamstring, it is like 12 weeks. But the ligamentation happens both in BTB and the hamstring at 9 months only. If the guy who is going with bone tendon bone and 4 months time, his re-injury rate will be very, very high. And he will again come back with a failed ACL reconstruction.
I think, Samantha bhai, I fully agree, like the other day, I fully agree with what you're saying. And the only thing I feel is that unless and until you provide a rotational stability in the periphery, a structure which is towards the axis of rotation cannot provide the same degree.
It cannot.
So you need to have that additional. The other thing is, somehow I feel through the years that the bone patellar tendon bone, because it is not a tendon, actually it is a ligament, the quality is different. It is not a question of healing inside the tunnel. I think that is wrong.
That is a totally wrong idea.
Only thing is, because it is basically a ligament, it is the collagen is different from the collagen of a tendon. Okay, you probably are able to do two things. One thing is that not a very anatomic bone patellar tendon bone is better tolerated than a non-anatomic hamstring tendon, because the collagen tissue is more rigid. And therefore, it would tolerate a non-anatomic procedure far more than what a hamstring tendon would tolerate. That is probably the reason why, a little bit of earlier mobilization, because you cannot really follow our patients as well, even our sportsmen as well. So if a bone patellar tendon bone guy goes back to his sports a little early, that is still tolerable, but you cannot tolerate to have a hamstring pivoting. Go to earth.
In pivoting sports, you cannot.
I agree with you. With pivoting shorts, yes. So the failure rates eventually will remain the same.
I don't think it will be any different.
If
you don't address the lateral corner, if the guy is anterolateral rotatory instability, whether you do the hamstring or the bone tendon, he will again come back with a failure. If he wants to play football.
Dr. Samantha, can I ask a question?
Sir, aap hukum kijiye.
Nahin. See, how long it takes for the tendons of Semiti and Gracilis to regenerate?
Because regenerate means that Leger 10 phenomena you are telling me? Leger 10 phenomena?
No. Regeneration of the tendon back.
No, you are talking of the graft, the graft side regeneration, or even ligamentization.
Ligamentization, I think he is asking.
No.
He is asking about the regeneration phenomenon. Donor side, that is known as the lizard tail phenomena. That means if you cut off the lizard's tail, it will come back again.
Yes, yes.
So that is known as the lizard tail phenomena. It usually takes 6 to 9 months to even 1 year to have the full strength. It can, the semite can be fully grown along that tunnel. That is known as the lizard tail phenomenon. Yes.
Now the lizard is very important to do the cutting manures. You as a Bengali, I as a Goan know.
Yes.
Taking out from one side, adding on the outer side, how much will the balance shift?
No, I am not adding the semite or the lateral side.
LED you are adding, no?
LED I am doing only with the IT band, sir. Only with the IT band, only with the modified Lehmeyer. I am doing hamstring 4-strand for the ACL and a modified Lehmeyer, classic modified Lehmeyer with the either the screw or the staple on the lateral side, which has been like your proximal and posterior to the FCL attachment.
No, my point is of discussion is with you. One sir. Side is weak. And other side, outer side, lateral side is strong.
That means if there is any consequence of taking the hamstring,
there is an imbalance.
No, it is not.
That's why they fail. And that's why they fail when they play before 9 months.
Yes. So the thing is that the return to play, there are certain criteria about the hamstring and quads. So it has to be like 85% of the normal to 90% of the other limb. So usually at the end of 9 months, when you order the patient to go back to the sports, even with your isokinetic study, they usually regain, even with the hamstring, that 85 to 90% of your hamstring strength, if you go with the classic physiotherapy for the professional players. It is no harm taking in the low long-term harm of taking the hamstring from the as the graft. Even the BTB has got the much more complications rather than taking the hamstrings. Even if you take the BTB, I will caution with the newcomers that if you take the BTB, there might be extension loss of 2 degrees. And remember that if you lose 2 degrees extension loss, that is more or less like 20 degrees flexion loss. Even with the 2 degrees, the problem is not only people can walk, but there will be easy fatigue liability. So that guy will never be able to go for the 90-minute game. I think Antao sir, that satisfied your question.
Because most people for contact sports do not use hamstrings. They use PTB.
No, the problem is that is the idea. The people say that the BTB, bone tendon bone, is stronger than the HT. But if you have seen my slides, 4 slides were there. It is the idea that has been printed in our brain that BTB is not much stronger and stiff graft than the 4-strand hamstring. But if you 10 of the hamstring and 10 of the BTB, the original ACL is 2000. Bone tendon 10 millimeter is 21,000 and 4-strand hamstring is 4090 sort of thing. So it is twice stronger than your bone tendon bone graft.
Dada, can I interrupt?
Sir, obviously.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, Dada, just before Alan get good, he has come up with his paper like you add hamstring to the LET. We have gone through the literature and we have seen that. In fact, there are n number of papers which has suggesting BTB with LET. BTB with LET has shown in a series which has been shown, now I don't remember, but 110 patients they have shown where BTB works better with LET. That's, we can't discuss BTB is better or hamstring is better. Both are good.
Because we have been probably...
Samil, any reason given for this?
Probably, I tell you, reason, what
Narvekar sir said, now, like it's a ligament.
I will give you the answer of that. Because the Alan Gatewood, probably it was not studied by the Alan Gatewood. It was a lot many Europeans and also the Canadian peoples were there in the stability
group. That was the Isakos group study. Isakos consensus.
That was headed by two people. One is Charlie Brown, another one the Alan Gatewood. Okay. So the study was done only with the hamstring and the LET, modified Lehmeyer. Now the stability study is on. And now they are taking 3 parameters. One is the hamstring. One is your quad tendon and one is the bone tendon along with the LET. Now, once the stability stool study comes out, which is funded by the Canadian government now, so then only will be probably stamp on it whether the bone tendon LET, hamstring LET, or the quad tendon LET is better. Till date, if you consider thus the hamstring and the bone tendon, your hamstring, I think that debate will probably go on for another 100 years. That is not going to be solved, because you know that I'll be, whenever I will go, I will tell you that hamstring is better. You will tell me the bone strength, BTB is better. But I'm not going to admit that it is better than that. But if I sometime I go with the BTB debate, I will prove that BTB is better than that.
Okay.
So if there are no further questions.
You have seen more failures in BTB or hamstrings?
I have seen, sir, both.
When there's a failure of hamstrings, you PTB. But then when there's a failure of PTB, do you use hamstrings? Tell me.
Sir, obviously, you can use that. Problem is
Where is it written?
Sir, what?
Where it is written when the PTB fails, use hamstring. Can you show me the literature?
No, I cannot quote the literature.
You can use
any tendon, like you can use the hamstring, you can use the quadriceps tendon. Also, you can see nowadays people are telling in the revision scenario, you can go with the peroneus longus also. But thing is that whenever the bone tendon bone is failing, the problem is also your tunnel. The tunnel is a big problem. Also in the bone tendon bone.
Sorry, if you allow me, I will just make a comment.
Yes.
I will totally agree with all these speakers that whenever I started my career with BTB, and that time whenever whatever number of cases I used to do, the BTB, the stability intraoperatively was fantastic. And the moment, I think in late 2005, 2006, the hamstring boom came. We all got converted from BTB surgeon to the hamstring surgeon. And now we started hating BTB. But surprisingly, the stability which you used to get with the BTB graft was far, far, far superior than the hamstring graft intraoperatively. I don't know about
it. See, can I just mention again what I said. That a BTB graft, when you were doing, we used to do it from up to 1998. 99 is the first time I started doing my hamstrings. The thing is that we were doing trans-tibial BTB. We never did at that point of time a transportal BTB. We did trans-tibial BTB. So as you can see that it was not really anatomic, but yet the patients did fairly well. The reason is because, again, as I said earlier, that a non-anatomic graft, if you put, then a BTB is tolerated far better than a hamstring. That is why when you started doing hamstrings trans-tibial, you realize that these guys loosened out much earlier as compared to the BTB. Yes. And that is the reason why you shifted from, then you said, you know, there is some problem here. And then you started looking at anatomy. Freddie Fu started looking at the anatomy. And then I still remember his statement saying that all those patients whom I have operated and done trans-tibial, I think they should come back to me and take a refund because I'm feeling guilty. I should have been doing transportal and I should have been doing anatomy. So
he said once you started...
Abhay sir,
he said it in Parla.
Dr. Abhay?
Yes.
Parla meeting, I remember.
Roshan boss?
Yes, sir.
So this question is for Abhay sir.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
So this question. So between a trans-tibial patella tendon versus a transportal hamstring.
Yes.
So you have been doing so many surgeries for so many years.
Yes.
So which is the better option? A trans-tibial PTB or a transportal hamstring?
A transportal hamstring.
Transportal hamstring.
But if you ask me whether you would do a transportal BTB, then maybe only, not looking at LET, but only looking at BTB in the same procedure, then a BTB transportal would be better than a hamstring transportal.
Hmm.
And other things that you can take into consideration, like Dr. Antao said, is that if you're a footballer, then you definitely require those hamstrings far more. And, they take a much longer time to strengthen out. And that is why, again, they are basically agonists for your ACL. You have taken them out. And that is the reason why when you're looking at the fine tuning of the knee that is maybe required is not there. So I'm sure if Anta were to, not now, but 20 years ago, if Anta would have had an ACL, he would have asked for a BTB. Antal, you would have asked me to do about.
Sir, this is a final question to two of my gurus. I have got them, like Narvekar sir and Antal sir. Why, if you admit that the BTB graph 10 millimeter is weaker than the...
Absolutely right. This is the question.
10 millimeter. Why people sell BTB is stronger? I think they make the joint stiff rather than stable.
You're right. We are not talking about strength. That is, you're talking about is pull-out strength. When you're talking about the rigidity, no. The stiffness of the graft is different. Samantha bhai, you don't require a graft actually, which is more than probably 16 or 1700, which is probably much more than your native ACL. You are putting four times the amount of that graft, but still you're getting failures. That means something is wrong.
That means it's non-anatomic.
You understand?
That means it is non-anatomic.
Either it is not only non-anatomic, but basically the stiffness of the graft is different. The stiffness of the patellar tendon and the stiffness of the hamstring tendon is entirely different. And that is the reason why what you want here is stiffness.
So
when Roshan says that, you know, immediate post-operative rigidity lagta hai, well, rigidity is because of the type of graft. It is collagen. Collagen. I don't think it is related really to all this, but I still fully agree that if you want to correct rotation, that has to be from the periphery.
Sir, my last question you have to answer. Antav sir, this is question to Antav sir only. Whether after ACL reconstruction on table, you do pivot shift, yes or no?
I first to see side to side. I would straight away won't go for pivot. Especially if I have done hamstrings, if there is additional capsular laxity with side to side movement, I will check for pivot, but it is not necessary.
My questions are different. After ACL reconstruction, suppose you have pre-op, you see that there is no lateral problem, but if you after ACL reconstruction routine, suppose you are 50 cases. After ACL, whatever graft you are doing, whether you check pivot on table before closing the wound? Yes,
I don't
know.
I don't check.
I always check it.
Narvekar, sir?
We don't check.
I don't check when I have done the ACL, only the ACL, but whenever I do a extra articular, I always check because the extra articular, I do it for pivots which are grade 2 and grade 3. So those I want to make sure that this is only for my information, just to see how good. I know I can't change anything once I've done the surgery at the end of it. So the thing is that I would do it whenever I've done an LET, even today. And I, as a matter of fact, not only that I do it, I just ask my assistant to do it, my fellows to do it, just to see that pre-operatively kaisa tha and post-operatively kaisa hai, just to know what really happens.
They are
the ones who are...
Let me reframe the question by Dr. Swanendu.
Is it pre-operative decision or yes, on-table decision? Yes. That is the question.
LET is a pre-operative decision or on-table?
Mostly it is pre-operative.
Mostly it's pre-operative, but sometimes it is intra-op also. If you have done an ACL reconstruction, you see there is a grade 3 pivot and you don't see any other reason apart from your the ramp lesion or bucket handle meniscal tear or root tear. And everything is fine and still you get a explosive pivot, then I think there is nothing wrong in adding.
But Roshan, most of us don't check after ACL the rotary instability. That is what we had discussed also time and again.
What is the harm in checking?
No, that is where, Swarnendu, that is where the problem is. Problem is the people who believe in BTB, they will always check intra-op about pivot and always pivot is negative. People who believe in hamstring, I'm also a hamstring fan. I have completely sold out to hamstring now. People who are doing hamstring, they're reluctant because sometimes they feel that it can stretch out and it can create an artificial grade 2 pivot shift or grade 3 pivot shift, which may require additional procedure.
I'll tell you why. One of the reasons I don't do it is only because I do it with a leg holder. So with the leg holder there, it is not possible. So I have to remove the leg holder, be there till the end of the surgery, before the dressing is done, then do the pivot, and then ask them to do the dressing. So because it is inconvenient, I don't do it.
Raghubir is a good guy. Binay, bolo, iske baad Raghubir.
Roshan boss.
Yeah.
Roshan boss, you being so happy with PTB, you said earlier you used to use PTB. Why did you shift to hamstring? What was the reason? Prime reason for shifting to hamstring?
Fashion.
Fashion?
Yeah, it's a big fashion. See, okay. Somebody who's taking one and a half hours so for ACL reconstruction and other surgeon is doing it in 20 minutes, 30 minutes. It's very easy. Hamstring is quick.
So if you want suppose if you want tomorrow ACL done for you, what graft would you like to have? Hamstring or PTB?
At my age, hamstring. Yes. At my this age, 46, I will do hamstring. I will not.
You are young, Roshan.
No, I'm 46, 47.
You're older than you.
Let's move on. Yeah. Let's move on, Roshan, now. Let's invite Samir.
But we didn't get the answer.
We didn't get the answer. again, the same question will come again in the next video. We have to solve my question because otherwise I am not going to go.
What is the question?
Question to Raghubir now. Because Raghubir is a big number surgeon. The question is whether he does pivot shift after is the completion of ACL before closing the wound, yes or no?
Another question of same type, Raghuveer, do you decide your extra-articular procedure, lateral extra-articular procedure, before the surgery by clinical examination and associated findings, or on table? That is the question.
Roshan, mera ek mithi hai. Roshan, ye question ka solution aaj mere ko nikalna hai.
Yes, okay, sir. Okay, sir. Wait. Okay. Raghuveer is answering.
Yeah, LAT I will do is the preoperative decision, but after ACL, every time I do latch can because sometimes it is not checking. Hello. Sometimes graft might become
loose. Yes,
Go ahead.
I'm just sharing a slide. That's it.
The button might come down, flip up and down. That is the reason I do a latchman after my ACL, not a pivot test.
So, Samantha boss, this is pre-operative decision to add LET. So, if you are not going to do anything after checking the pivot shift on table after finishing your ACL, what's the point of doing pivot shift?
But I am not satisfied. I am not satisfied.
So what answer you want? Tell me.
I want whether what is the harm in doing the pivot shift after your ACL?
But if you are not going to decide about a lateral fixation, say okay, if that pivot shift is positive, the LET is reserved for explosive pivots, grade 2 or more pivot. You will get grade 1 pivot. So what would you do? Tell me.
No, that's why I am asking whether
actually
to act
Sanjay,
on
yes. what Samantha is saying is right. That as a rule, I think I agree with him. You must document whether that pivot shift, which was positive preoperatively, whether under anesthesia or whatever, and you had planned to do the LET, has disappeared after your procedure. I think he is absolutely right. You cannot presume that it is gone because somebody else says that if you do an LET, it goes away. And we should document it. I think I fully agree with what he's saying. Yes, we are wrong in not doing, there's no question. I told you the reason why I don't do. But I think what he's saying is right. And when you are making that registry and you know whatever, I think we should write what were the physical finding before and what are the physical finding on table after. I think he's absolutely right.
See, pivot shift phenomena, which is described by Andrew Amis, is as two planes, anterior translation and internal rotation. So whenever you have to check the internal rotation, can you see the slide?
Yes.
So whenever you have to see the internal rotation, it has to buy a pivot shift test. You cannot check your pivot shift or rotary instability without doing a pivot shift test. So this is must and mandatory. And positive pivot is again, and there is another article which says that exact structure that is necessary to damage and produce a pivot shift are unclear, but it denominates that ACL deficiency, combined ACL deficiency, or isolated lateral structure without torn ACL. So these are the three causes which has been enlightened for your positive pivot. So unless you rule out all these fragments, factors, you can't proceed with your future surgery. So I feel intra-op decision is one and pre-op decision is another. If I have done the pre-op decision of not doing pivot, but if I not doing the ALL, but during the surgery, if I think the ACL is not that tight and I'm getting a pivot shift test, I will surely add a LET.
Okay, thank you, Roshan.
Roshan, I want to ask you, suppose now I have decided to a BTB. I have done a BTB, I have checked it on table. BTB plus LET, I have decided preoperatively to do. But after surgery with the BTB, I don't find any pivot shift. Pivot shift is negative.
then you don't do it. If you satisfied that the pivot stiff, why to add on the laterals of the structure, make it stiff?
Then most of the time after BTP, you get the pivot negative. Then what's the point in adding LAT?
If you are happy
But you would have the same situation even after hamstrings.
Even after hamstring.
You would have a pivot which is negative after hamstring. But the reason, one of the other reasons why you're doing it is because of a high load. That is why I think Sanjay said that it is a preoperative diagnosis. Yes. A preoperative decision. That yes, I'm going to do LET not only because how my graft is going to be inside, but because there are 1, 2, 3, 4 factors.
This message should be there, Samir, it is a preoperative decision.
Samir, listen to me. The problem is that in OPD, the second grade pivot, sometimes after anesthesia becomes explosive pivot. That is another one problem. A Narvekar, sir.
Yes.
Sometimes your second degree pivot in OPD becomes explosive after anesthesia. That is the other problem.
Correct. Absolutely. I agree with you. The question is how much internal rotation you're able to give. So if the patient is relaxed, you'll be able to give more internal rotation.
Yes. That is.
And internal rotation in extension is the reason for the pivot. Because now when you flex it, it will become the pivot shift phenomenon. It's only because you're able to subluxate the tibia in the absence of an ACL and some other structures that you start getting the pivot. The pivot is nothing but reduction of the subluxated ACL. Sorry.
Okay. So if there is, I think, a lot of discussion on one topic. Sanjay, can we proceed?
I think the conclusion is Amanda wanted. And that is that everybody is going to do the pivot post-operatively before this thing. If the pivot was positive, pre-operative. What your procedure will do. And Dr. Samantha?
Can we make a consensus study on these? Now we have a study group. I can request maybe Dr. Pradeep Nimade or Sandeep Birares to make a consensus form on how to address the pivot. Maybe a pre-op decision, post-op decision, inter-op decision.
Yes,
we can. I think
we can do that. Pradeep, can we make, because now we have almost more than 100 members. I think contribution from 100 members will become a very good opinion, which can be framed as an article.
Surely, sir, we'll work on that.
I think we should do that.
We can
formulate the questionnaire or something like that.
Yeah,
that is the question. Google form is better idea.
Google form, and we can just submit it, and that is the best way.
So this will only give you information in terms of statistics, is how many people do post-operative pivot and how many don't. बाद में कुछ आने वाला नहीं. What Samantha is saying is important, that you instruct everybody that this is the type of study we are doing, that whichever graph you are using, do your pre-operative pivot. Let us know what is your post-operative pivot. What is the graph that is used? Both are done under anesthesia. Whether you do it with LET, without LET, whatever. So at least you will know whether the pivot disappears. And then you can probably get a sort of a study in saying that those who probably did only this graph, the pivot didn't go. Those who did this, pivot went.
Yes.
Okay.
I think otherwise it will be statistics. You can note the point.
But it is
make it a more clinical study.
Right. But you need to have that information and then you can build on that.
Yes. Correct.
Basic practice is what 100 people are doing. Yeah. Today we are only 15 people, but if we get that information, how many, like me, I don't do after ACL pivot testing. So, you know, accordingly.
I think Pradeep and Sandeep, 100 people. Pradeep, it is a very simple questionnaire, 5-10 questions, 3-5 questions only. You can take a study from 100 people in our arthroscopy group, study group itself.
Yes, we'll do that.
Sir, if I suggest just one thing.
Okay, let's.
Yes.
People are comfortable doing pivot after ACL on table? A full flesh pivot. I'm not saying it's very difficult to, you know, challenge yourself on table.
No, it is not a problem. But because I am not going to add anything after that pivot, I don't do. That is my statement.
Exactly, sir.
But if you want to do, you can do. For study purpose, we can do without destabilizing your recently performed surgery. So that's not a big problem.
All of us
actually
do a draw test after ACL. I feel I at least do my draw test, but I never, you know, that confidence or that fear always remains on giving a full flesh pivot force on the.
Siddharth, after I fix my ACL, I always with the probe check my tension into the graph. I don't do any drawer test. I don't do any drawer. But pivot, I was not doing because I was not thinking of adding anything if it is a grade 1 pivot. Or, you know, my LET is always preoperative decision. That's the reason. But today, I got another thought process. I'll process it and I'll try to incorporate. That is why this study group is there.
Let's try it out and let's see what amounts.
So if you see the last article we are discussing the journal where the author routinely performed the pivot shift at the end of the surgery. So there, they had a total pivot shift of grade 2, grade 3 pivot shift around 36, and that has reduced to 10. So around 26 people who had previously grade 2 or grade 3 pivot got decreased to grade 1 or less than that.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. That's a good one. But I think this is a good topic actually.
yeah. We'll study on it.
Yeah.
I think we should move on to the next talk, Sanjay.
Okay. Yes. Just Samir, are you ready?
I will take 5 seconds. I will 5 seconds only, please.
Given.
I will request, please read the article by Ferrati. There is a study of 10 cases with navigation opposed in the intra of pivoting, and they have given that 10% when they are not doing the LET, the pivot is there. When they are doing the LET, pivot is not there. That is Ferretti's article. I will request to read that article.
Okay, no problem. We'll go through the journal.
Andrea did speak with us and he had the findings of the ALL tear, and in certain cases he used to do that. So MRI findings also have to be included in the survey.
Yes.
Roshan boss.
Yeah.
Okay, Sanjay, we can move ahead.
One last question. One last question. how many of us are checking for engagement after doing a bankart repair? How many of us?
Oh, I think that's a question for different day. This is not the point.
We are going in a wrong track now.
I think we should leave it there.
This debate is not going to solve.
I think full stop. Samir, please share your screen and start your presentation on ACL plus MCL now. Please start sharing it. Vinay, we can discuss this at a relevant moment.
Single row, double row sentiment.
Welcome, Samir.
Roshan has given short time for me to prepare this.
Roshan gives always like, moments notice.
12 hours something.
You should be brave to say no if you cannot.
Yeah. And it's a huge topic like ACL plus MCL to talk on for this 10 minutes. Just bear with me. So I won't go in details of technique of ACL or anything else. Am I audible, Sanjay?
Yes, Samir.
Okay. So regarding now ACL plus MCL injury general, I went through the literature once the Roshan told me, and I came across almost 40 to 50 papers, and the conclusion what they have given, I came with one algorithm what everybody has followed up till now. So routinely, as we know, like ACL, it's again anteromedial postural bundle. It depends on what you are doing, whether you are doing anatomical or a double bundle when there is ACL plus MCL. And about MCL, as all know, after coming the studies by the Robert Laprade and the Martin Lind, we know that superficial MCL as well as POL is needed to address when there is a valgus instability, if it is more than and almost in 30 degrees as well as at 0 degrees. And we do it only superficial MCL if it is at 30 degrees. So how the mechanism of the injury, initially we thought of just it's a hyperflexion, external rotation coupled with valgus is the usual mechanism where we get. But again, one paper has come up which showed that there are sometimes internal rotation with varus stress also has been reported in the literature. So now either both the mechanisms can be there. So we know now that there is another mechanism. On MCL examination, ACL examination, usually now, as we discussed a lot, like we do all of us, we do Lachman test, anterior drawer test, and pivot shift. Now, pivot shift, initially it might be a 1 plus or 2 plus, and then it becomes on under examination, under anesthesia, it might become 3 also. We know that. And opening at 30 degrees as well as opening at 0 degrees is very important when we are doing taking a decision about ACL and MCL reconstruction, or whether we are doing a repair. Because at 30 degree, if it is only opening, then it means it's a superficial component of the MCL which has been torn. And if it's at 0 degree, then it is associated with a POL, that is a posteromedial capsule. So the current literature, the recent paper which has come up in the current orthopedics, is that the combined, if there is a combined injury, anterior cruciate ligament and a medial collateral ligament injury, and anatomy, diagnosis, management, they have come up to the conclusion that most authors agree on reconstructing the ACL with non-operative management of MCL in grade 1 and grade 2 injuries, respectively. Not just only this paper, but there are certain, at least 15 to 20 papers, which now they say that this is the scenario. And the controversy still exists about the optimal method of treating a combined ACL with high-grade MCL injury. And as I said, the initially mechanism, what we saw, it was a dominant valgus stress and external rotation. But this paper, they have presented 4 patients and they have shown that there was an avulsion fracture of medial collateral ligament associated with the SIGINT fracture. And they suggest that there can be a varus stress as well as internal rotation, which is associated with that. One more interesting paper, initially when we started, like in April 2012, there was a paper in knee surgery sports. What they said, like, you do a primary reconstruction of MCL as well as ACL if it's a grade 3. But they have studied a short group of patients, that is only 22 patients. Follow-up was 2.5 years with good results. So it's a little bit dilemma in the literature, where we see that primary reconstruction of MCL as well as ACL is a bit less in the literature. One more paper I have gone through, that in a pediatric journal or the pediatric orthopedics, where they say like a combined ACL and MCL, if it is there in adolescents, they have done 180 patients for ACL plus 2 and 3 grade MCL, and all were treated conservatively for the MCL with MCL hinge knee brace and ACL reconstruction using transfacial technique. And bracing of grade 2 or 3 MCL injuries followed by ACL reconstruction has shown excellent results. Most of them have gone back to their sporting activities also, according to this paper, which has come up, and they have studied 180 patients. So I think this gives you more idea. And from this, all the literature, what I have gathered, I came to the conclusion that if there is an acute ACL plus MCL injury, and it's a ACL plus grade 1 MCL, we should treat them conservatively followed by ACL reconstruction. ACL plus MCL grade 2 injury, treated conservatively with hinge knee brace, evaluated them after 2 months, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, and then followed by ACL reconstruction. And if there is an ACL with MCL that is grade 3, then the stage treatment, that is MCL repair plus or minus augmentation followed by the ACL reconstruction, this is most favored in the literature. But now, as I said, one paper which has said like there should be a primary MCL repair or ACL reconstruction. This is the scenario what, according to literature, about the acute ACL plus MCL injury. But when the patient presents to us late, that is a chronic scenario. When the chronic ACL and MCL injury is there, we need to evaluate the patient and clinically. That is, we have to see the valgus test, Lachman test, pivot shift test, Lachman test, even at 0 degrees and 30 degrees. If there is a valgus test positive at 30 degrees only and not at 0 degrees, opening is only up to 4 mm in stress express, and ACL injury is there, should go ahead with doing a ACL reconstruction plus superior MCL reconstruction. Or if it is positive valgus test at 0 degree and 30 degrees both, and opening is more than 9 to 10 mm, and ACL injury, then might ACL plus anatomic laparoid MCL reconstruction, that is what I do it. But some there are so many procedures in the literature, like Martin Lind has published, other so many authors has published. You can go ahead accordingly. And in chronic cases, very important thing is that you need to see the alignment of the knee. Whether there is a valgus alignment or varus alignment, then you should go ahead and do it. So indications for surgical repair of acute MCL injury, in the literature, if you see, it's only the MCL interposition under the medial meniscus, PBL avulsion, bony avulsion, or the knee, that is valgus malalignment, and is there, you need to do that. And Sonri Kotet has come up with a paper like, if ACL and MCL is associated, you should search for some hidden lesions, and the ramp tears are also very important, if you can see. And even the hidden lesions like the meniscotibial ligament disruption, as well as the ramp lesion is very important to find out. And if ramp lesion is there, you need to tackle the same thing along with any lateral meniscus injury or medial meniscus injury is there, okay? You have to find out. So this is the scenario. Now, if ACL and PCL, ACL plus MCL is there, for ACL, what I do in my practice is single bundle anatomical ACL reconstruction in most of the patients, that is quadrupled hamstrings, what we do. And sometimes six bundle also now we have started doing majority. And usually in the anterior knee pain and the kneelers, we do the quadrupled hamstrings. And BTB, when I do it in a hypermobile demanding players. And if the footprint is less than 14 mm, usually if it footprint is more than 14 mm, still I am doing double bundle ACL reconstructions in players or the demanding young patients, I do it. And some patients, what we have done, gone across, like if there is acute ACL and MCL, tibial sided avulsion is there in this patient. This was a patient of almost 30 years. And in this patient, and she came acutely, then we have, as I said, we go ahead with a stage treatment for that. Like initially we have done a staple and a screw followed by the ACL reconstruction, that is in a stage treatment. This is the case in 2001, what I have done, like if you see, it was ACL, PCL and MCL was there. There was a valgus opening, but that time we have treated this patient only with a conservative means, and that time we were using the transfix as well as ACL and PCL, both we have done, and we have done a conservative treatment for the MCL, but still this patient is doing well. Then going ahead, like when we came across ACL plus MCL plus patella tendon avulsion was there, this was an interesting case, as where I did a valgus stress was positive at 30 degrees and anterior drawer and Lachman was positive. In this case, as at 0 degrees, we didn't found any much more opening of the So we went ahead and did a patella tendon repair, ACL. Along with that, we did a superficial MCL reconstruction. When I'm doing a superficial MCL reconstruction, you don't need to open completely. You can do it by a minimal invasive method. You can find out the point and at the MCL, that is proximal and posterior to the medial epicondyle, and you can and place your tunnel for the femoral tunnel, and then you can use a hamstring or a peroneus, and then and just pass the graft below the fascia and you can fix it. This was the case where ACL reconstruction was done, superficial MCL reconstruction was done, and a patellar tendon repair was done, might be in 2001 or 2002. This was the another case. Now, as we went ahead, initially we were doing superficial reconstruction only, as well as reefing of the POL. But now, one more case I would like to share with you. Now, we have started doing anatomical laparotomy since he has come up with excellent results and the papers. This was again a case where there was a 6 months back history with the valgus stress positive at 0 and 30 degrees, anterior Lachman and anterior Rawus was there, which showed both stress views also, it was opening more than 9 to 10 mm. In such scenarios, what we did, it was a complete ACL tear and MCL grade 3. Then we went ahead and done an anatomic MCL reconstruction along with the ACL reconstruction. ACL reconstruction has been done. After that, you all know, for the anatomic laparotomy, we are making two tunnels in the tibia, two tunnels in the femur, one tunnel for the tibia. For the superficial MCL, we are doing 6 cm below the joint line. And what we have done it here, and another for the POL, we first find out the semimembranous tendon, and then just above the semimembranous tendon, you get the POL insertions, direct insertion and EA. And then after POL making two tunnels, we make it for the femoral side. That is, first we identify the adductor tubercle by finding out the adductor magnus tendon, and over there, then we find the medial epicondyle, and the even for the gastroc tubercle, we find out, and then we point out the points for the two femoral tunnels. And we pass the graft as I have shown in this figure, and we reconstruct the, in chronic cases, we do the anatomical laparotomy itself. And after doing anatomical laparotomy, now we are happy with the results at present. So in short, what I have shown you the algorithm, the same thing what I follow Oh, in practice, like if ACL grade 3 is there, we do MCL repair followed by ACL reconstruction, and MCL repair plus ACL reconstruction at present I'm not doing in a one stage. And in chronic cases, very important thing is alignment of knee needs to be assessed. Thank you.
Thank you, Samir, for giving us the overview of your approach to this injury. This is now open for discussion. So, Samir, when you say that you, for in acute cases, for grade 3 MCL, you first repair. So, what is the acute case according to you? Up to what time you repair and then wait and then at a second stage do ACL?
I repair acute repairs if the patient comes to me within 3 weeks, almost 20 to 21 days. And after MCL repair, if patient regains its full range of motion, almost you can say it up to 3 months or 4 months, even I can wait still that. And after that, I go ahead and do that. Meanwhile, even bone bruise and all the conditions get settled over there, and it's better to do that. That's what I follow. But I know Roshan, he is doing one stage ACL and MCL. What is take on?
Yes, Roshan.
Yeah, I do one stage ACL MCL depending on the instability. If it is grade 3 instability of MCL, I do always do MCL repair. Along with that, I do ACL reconstruction, because I believe that unless you do the complete repair, you're not going to give a complete stability to knee joint.
So time consumed by both the methods is almost same at the end of the day, because when you do acute ACL and MCL, Roshan, your rehab takes long time, isn't it?
Yeah, it takes long time, but I think then I'm dealing with a very, very stable joint. That is one, because I don't have a rotary instability, neither do I have a AP instability. And that gives me a good point for my MCL healing also. Because
sometimes, Roshan, out of 10 cases, if we do, two patients, they suffer with some arthrofibrosis or they are dealing with some...
Yeah,
this,
because...
This is the scenario what we see.
Yes. That is a very reasonable argument. But, you know, since the time I started a very aggressive rehab, we started getting better result. Because if you immobilize them for a very long time, you tend to get arthrofibrosis. But if you mobilize them very fast, maybe... within a week time, you will never get arthrofibrosis. In fact, you will get a fantastic range of motion.
Okay, Shami.
I think arthrofibrosis is not dependent on the mobilization only. Sanjay, it is Sanjay. Also dependent on the other issues also.
Yeah.
Sanjay, yes, sir.
Yeah, Anta, sir.
You mean to say, Samir,
sir.
You said grade 2 you do MCL repair, right? Acute.
No, sir. Grade 3 we do MCL repairs.
That's open, right?
Yes, sir. Grade 3. That's why.
You mean to say you don't do arthroscopy at all? Suppose say there's an ACL avulsion. Suppose say there's a meniscal tear. Then what do you do?
Yes, sir. In that scenario, if MCL is associated with that, immediate fast first look arthroscopy, what we say, we go inside, we see if there is a bucket angle meniscus, you reduce it and you can put one or two suture just inside out or just all inside sutures and come out. This is the time when you can do it, when there is a bucket handle meniscus tear or if there is a something locked scenario is there. Otherwise, sir, it's like we can wait for ACL reconstruction.
Suppose ACL is avulsed from femur, then you would not do something at the same
ACL,
time?
ACL, if it is associated with a bony avulsion at the femoral side, definitely I would like to fix that bony avulsion. If it's a large enough piece, we can put one suture anchor over there and we can fix it. But if it's a soft tissue, just avulsed sleeve, then the literature says, sir, like healing potential is far, far better than the tibial side. So in grade 2 MCL, no, if it is
that
there.
That is MCL. ACL I'm talking about. ACL avulsed from the femoral side.
ACL avulsed from femoral side, sir, I don't do any repairs.
So he's talking about femoral repair.
Yeah. I don't do any repairs until and unless it's a clear cut avulsed and is sitting in front of that. I've done at least now 4 cases of femoral sided repair. Not more than that I've done, sir.
Samir.
Yes.
What's your take on internal bracing of MCL in acute scenarios? Do you do that?
Yes. Internal bracing, if it is there, if it's an acute MCL tear and it's a mid-substance tear, then it's always better to add on augmentation, and I do it routinely.
Rajiv,
Dr. Sameer, can you speak?
Yes, sir.
Sir, the third case that you showed, the quadriceps, patellar tendon plus ACL plus MCL.
Yes, sir.
The case that is the quadriceps tendon repair and the ACL that you did.
Yeah.
We did it all in the same setting, sir?
Yeah, we did it in one setting in that case. Because patient presented to us 2 months later. Already, okay. He was there in the same scenario. Then already 2 months has passed. Then no point in doing repair or nothing else. Then we went ahead and did a MCL reconstruction. Patellar tendon repair, it was IVL. So we placed the two suture anchors over there and placed it.
Okay. And what about your mobilization post that?
Yes. After that, sir, mostly after we have waited up to the 8 to 10 days and immediately mobilization has been started because aggressive rehab was the key in that case. When we started.
So what about your patellar tendon? You fixed it with two anchors.
Not patellar tendon. It was partially avulsed from the tibial tuberosity. That's what we fixed it. But almost, if you say 50% of the patellar tendon was intact.
Okay. But it was a partial avulsion basically.
Partial avulsion.
So, okay. That was my concern with the patellar tendon because I have burned my fingers twice with that type of scenario. Okay. That's why I was specifically concerned.
Okay. Rajiv wanted to ask a question. Yeah.
Roshan, this is for you because you do in single stage ACL and reconstruction and MCL repair. So if you are aggressive in your rehab, would you try to go for some biological augmentation? Because only repair, you can't be very aggressive in your rehabilitation.
Roshan, unmute yourself. Roshan, unmute yourself. Yeah.
Sorry. I am muted. I didn't.
Rajiv, ask again.
Yeah, for MCL repair, you told you are very aggressive. You follow a very aggressive plan for rehabilitation. So whether you do some augmentation or you isolated repair, you go with an aggressive rehab plan.
Usually, I don't do any augmentation. I do a repair in case the tissue is very bad. In case I am not able to repair it, then I'll consider for a augmentation. I do primary repair. And there is a literature backing it. I'm not saying because I have to say it. I'll just share my screen for a literature. Probably you can see it now. Can you see it? So,
yes.
Combined chronic MCL.
Yes.
Acute repair, one stage reconstruction in ACL. There are enough papers to suggest that grade 3 MCL with POL lesion, 0 to 30 degree instability, and significantly you can manage both the instabilities at one time. There is from a wonderful result in these cases. And if you don't tackle it, it becomes a chronic insufficiency which need to be tackled. So I better to do whenever you are addressing a grade 3 MCL, better to tackle the injury at one go.
And what about if bone bruises are there, your tenels are a bit feeling like soft bone, it is there.
That is where I consider the lint technique. If you see the lint, you get a bruise on one side. The lint technique. You don't put any on the femoral side. This is a lint technique. Share the screen. Can you see it now, Sam?
No.
So I tendinosis graft lint technique, and then you can, you know, it's same. And this is where you can identify it, and then you can pass.
Now we can
graft.
See your screen.
Single screw. Yeah. Modification. Yeah?
No, it is blank screen.
We can't see.
Now yes, it sir. Is there. Now it is there.
Yeah, it's there now?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is for chronic case.
Even in acute cases, if you are not able to repair, Rajiv was asking whether you require augmentation. If you require augmentation, I will do BTB for ACL and I will use hamstring for the MCL. In case I don't require augmentation, then I will do only BTB grafting for my ACL reconstruction and then I'll conserve if it is type 2 and type 1 MCL injury. Hello.
Samir, can I ask?
Samir? Yes, Raghu.
Yes, Raghu.
Samir, you have treated a case of ACL, MCL. First, MCL with conservative management. Okay. Then afterwards, you do ACL. On the table, it is not opening in extension. But in 30 degrees, it opens to grade 2. So what will you do on the table?
MCL, we have done conservative treatment.
Yeah, huh? MCL, you did conservative
management. Yeah, if it's a grade 2, then you need to take a call how the patient is. Like if it's a high demand patient, then I would go and just reconstruction also along with that. And if it's not a high demand patient, routine activities are there, then this grade 2, you can leave as it is. Along once ACL has been done, that grade 2 will get converted Rina. Into a grade 1.
So stable in extension, but you're only opening in 30 degrees flex.
Then it's better to add a graft, sir. Then it's better to add a graft in 30 degrees. That is superficial MCL component has gone over there. If it's in 30 degrees opening. So just by doing a minimal invasive method, what I have shown, you can just open at the medial epicondyle level. You drill one hole over there and one hole in the 6 centimeter below here, and you can add on that. And if this happens, routinely this happens with all of us. Like a patient comes to us after 3 months and then we see that grade 2 is there. And better to get away with this.
You use graft or you use tape?
No, sir. I use graft. Most of the time, I use graft. Only if it's a mid-substance tear, acute MCL repair I am doing. And that time, if I feel like you need to augment that, meanwhile that mid-substance tear heals, we can add that one.
I think like we have discussed in our previous case lecture also, it's a preoperative assessment which is important. Suppose it's a grade 3 yes. MCL. After ACL reconstruction is grade 2, don't think that it's a grade 2. Treat it like grade 3 only. Yeah. I think that is more important.
Can I just make a comment? And this is further to what actually I think Sanjay was trying to hint at, that just looking at grade 2 and grade 3 and then trying to repair immediately. Okay, I think it is important whenever you are repairing, where you have the choice of reconstructing later on, is to look at the type of patient that you are facing.
Yes.
We can divide those patients into three types. One who are locomotor artists, that you can immobilize them for 6 months, they will get their movements in a couple of days. And there are locomotor idiots, that whether you mobilize them on day one, okay, they will still stiffen up. Most of us are in between. But if I think in your, more often than not, you're able to identify those people, the moment you talk to them or the moment you look at their knee, you have a fussy female, not allowed to touch her knee, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Mm. I would not basically repair her. Because I know that she's not going to mobilize and she's a 100% arthrofibrotic candidate. So you have to look at these sort of things before you know. And the other thing regarding your grade 2 with the ACL, you know, where you said that you have already repaired and you have a little grade 2 opening when you do your ACL reconstruction, what Samir said. So if I'm getting something which is more than grade 2 and like he said, if he's a little high level, only then I would go ahead and do an MCL. But otherwise, I don't think, because I'm sure my ACL graft would be good enough to take care of that medial opening. So often, are you opening your medial joint to do a meniscal repair, which is probably grade 2 plus when you're doing your ACL reconstruction. And these, over a period of time, over a period of 6 months to a year, you'd realize that they go on decreasing. They do not cause any stress. But yes, if it's high demand, if it is more than grade 2, I would exactly follow what Samir is saying.
Thank you, sir.
Abhay sir, I would like to ask you one question. Yeah. Like whether you use hamstrings in MCL, similar side, ipsilateral side hamstrings?
Yes, I do.
I also do the same. I don't think it really matters.
But yes, you can always take the bone, but we are going to be back to that same discussion. Then, whether BTB or hamstrings. So I think, you can take it.
Right. Any further questions? Well, I think then Rajiv Raman is ready to give us his presentation on ACL with PLC injury. So please share your screen. There you are.
Screen is shared. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm audible.
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah. So thank you. Excellent demonstration by my previous two speaker. And now it's ACL and lateral corner injury. And ACL with LCL tear is not a very uncommon scenario, or ACL with posterolateral condylar tear is not a very uncommon scenario. And what is most important in dealing with ACL with posterolateral corneal injury is see for the assessment of the lateral instability, whether it is an isolated LCR or it's an associated posterolateral corneal injury, because your treatment protocol will depend on that. And so I have made it a two case scenario. The first case, a 35-year army soldier having pain and giving way of the left knee for 6 months. And he has a trans-tibial ACL reconstruction 1 year back. And on examination, Latchman was positive and dial test is positive. So here what is important is that the patient is having antromedial instability, the patient is having a rotatory instability also. So in such type of patient, the fibula sling procedure is going to be a day one failure. So in those patients, you have to go for a Laprade type or tibial type of tibial sling procedure along with the fibula sling procedure to give good amount of rotational stability. And there is a small video demonstration. You can see the Latchman is positive, and you can see the positive dial test also among 60 to 70 degree of external rotation, which is there. So in this patient, you can see if the ACL reconstruction has been a trans-tibial, it's like a blessing in disguise, where you have a high tunnel over the lateral femoral condyle. So you can go for your routine anatomical ACL reconstruction. The only issue is that when you are planning if for your PLC reconstruction, there's a chance of tunnel merging of the tunnel over the area of the lateral epic condyle. So for ACL, it's good for you, but for LCR or PLC reconstruction, sometimes it's a challenge. So normally, I will not go through the steps of, we do a routine ACL reconstruction here. We did a routine ACL reconstruction with a semi-T graft from the opposite limb. And after the ACL reconstruction, we had planned for posterolateral corner reconstruction. And normally, I do it in a 90-degree flex position of the knee. It's a J-shaped incision extending 6 cm proximal in the distal part of the femur, in between the girdle stipendiae and tip of the fibula. And normally you take a posterior best flap, which is important and should be thick enough. Try to take a thick posterior best flap. And gradually dissect it with the subend of bicep femoris. So as you go downward, you can see the first and most important part is the neurolysis of the common peroneal nerve. So once you have identified your common peroneal nerve, hold it with a nerve tape and go for neurolysis for at least 5 to 6 cm. And now you make your first window at the level of lateral femoral lipar condyle. This is very important. And just you give a sharp incision over the lateral femoral lipar condyle and you make your first window there. And once you have identified your lateral femoral epicondyle, you can see here, because that is one of the important landmark for reconstruction of the posterolateral condyle. So you can put your colored pin there also. And the first step is creation of your fibular tunnel, which is from the antromedial to the posterolateral part. Most of the time, I don't use any jig. It's my finger, which I use as a protector. And now after passing a bead pin, try to drill it with a 4 mm or a 5 mm cannulated drill bit. And once you have drilled from the antromedial to the posterolateral part, try to put your fibular sling here, and you can see the fibular sling and take it out. And normally use different color sling for the tibial and the fibular tunnel. Now you make your tibial tunnel just over from the girdle stipendiae towards the posterolateral part of the tibia. Again, your finger should act like your protector, and you part your suture loop through the tibial tunnel. And here you can see it's a blue tip. So this step is very important. Normally you can see here, what I do, I put a pull through suture through the, you can see that this is your LCR and that is your popliteus. And the distance between two described by Laprade is 1.8 centimeter, 1.18 millimeter or 1.8 centimeter. So normally when you have a trans-tibial ACL reconstruction, your tibial tunnel is very close to that. So here putting two tunnels is very difficult. So now what I do, I prefer one tunnel in between the LCL and insertion of the popliteus. And so it will be a single socket over the femoral tunnel. So you can see here that this is my LCL, that is the popliteus is there. And so I will put a single socket there in between the LCL and popliteus sulcus. And this is important when you are dealing with a revision ACL or when you are dealing with the ACL which has been repaired with a trans-tibial technique. Now try to make your femoral socket and always try to pull your bead pin towards the superior pole of the patella. So first, drill through and through from the lateral part towards the medial cortex with a 4 0.5 millimeter rimmer, and then make your femoral socket and now pass your femoral pin. Here, we have used a quadriceps split tendon to reconstruct the posterolateral corner because we have a single femoral socket, you can see here. So try to put 20 to 25 millimeter of graft in the femoral socket. And once you have put your graft here, you can fix it with the interference screw, either a bias screw or a metallic screw. So once your 2 centimeter, 2.5 centimeter graft is there inside the femoral socket, fix it with a bias screw. Now you have two limbs of graft, this split graft. So pass your split graft from anterior to posterior aspect of the fibular tunnel and the another graft under the iliotibial tendon from the posterior aspect of the tibia toward the anterior aspect of the tibia. So with these two limbs only, you can reconstruct your LCL, you can reconstruct your popliteal ACL and oblique popliteal ligament, and try to take both the limb outside the tibial tunnel. And by this technique, the single femoral socket technique, you can assess a good rotational stability. And now once you both the end is outside from the anterior tibial socket, fix the graft with 60 to 70 degree of the knee flexion. And after the fixation, is very important to see for the assessment of the stability. You can see here the rotational stability. You can see it was 70 degree preoperatively, and peroperatively it is around 5 to 10 degree. So good amount of rotational stability, and the varices stress is also negative. So this is important. Whenever you are dealing a patient with ACL with a posterolateral rotatory instability, try to go for the tibial fibular base sealing procedure, not only fibular base sealing procedure, because that will be a day one failure. Scenario two, 25-year soccer player, pain and giving way of the left knee, history of twisting injury 6 years back, and the patient has a Latchman positive and varices test positive, but dial test is negative. So this is a different scenario where you have only single pelvic instability, there is no rotatory instability. In such type of patient, again, I usually with ACL with posterolateral corner go for ACL reconstruction, then I go for posterolateral reconstruction contradictory to PCL with PLC, where you go for a PCL first because you want to centralize your knee. Since your PCL is intact with ACL with LCL or ACL with PLC, you can reconstruct your ACL first and then go for your posterolateral corner reconstruction. So in such type of scenario where the dial test is negative and varices test is positive, you can go for a fibula sling procedure. And you can see the MRI, you can see this is classical sagging rope sign, and you can see here the whole of the LCL is torn, whole of the LCL is torn, and you can see here the varus patient, the varus stress test is positive. So again, the same position of the limb here, here I have done the ACL reconstruction with the quadriceps tendon graft, and the LCL reconstruction will be done by a semi-T graft. Again, your incision is same J-shaped incision, starting from the distal femur, in between the Gerdes tubercle and the tip of the fibula, and try to make a thick posterior based flap, and go for a gradual dissection, go for neurolysis of the common peroneal nerve, and once you have done the neurolysis of the common peroneal nerve, just I will skip this step. So this is the fibular sling procedure, the Larsen technique. So here again, I put my tack suture over. Most of the time in your neglected cases, you will see that you can put a tack suture to the LCL and you can identify the attachment of your lateral LCL. So again, a single tunnel in between the LCL and the popliteal sulcus, and guiding towards the superior pole of the patella so that it does not go towards the intercondylar notch, and try to drill it with your 5 millimeter cannulated drill. So your femoral socket is ready. And now once your femoral socket is ready, put your loop over the in the femoral tunnel, and you can see here, and you are dealing from the lateral cortex towards the medial cortex. So my 4 millimeter rimmer will go through and through. Now I have made the tibial tunnel from the lateral aspect to the posterior medial aspect, and you can see this is a fibular socket, and pass your loop through the fibular socket. So once you have passed your loop through the fibular socket, over that you can guide your semi-T tendon, and you can see here the semi-T tendon is passed from the fibular socket, and this is the fibula sling procedure where you are reconstructing the LCL and the oblique popliteal ligament only, because you are not reconstructing your posterolateral corner. Now put your guide wire in first and try to take the femoral socket loop and pull your graft through the in the femoral socket. A small technique here, because most of the time your graft will try to entangle over the mouth of the lateral femoral socket. So put an artery forceps here so that it goes perpendicular inside, and the you can see here. So once you put the artery forceps there, the whole of the graft can be pulled, and again fix it in 60 to 70 degree of the knee flexion. So you can see the stability, the perioperative stability. And what is important here, and I would like to share with you. So normally we have three scenario: dial test positive and varus stress test positive, and dial test positive and varus stress test negative. So whenever you are dealing with a rotator instability, don't go for a fibula sink procedure only. Try for a laparotomy, or you have to add a tibial sink procedure. But the scenario three, where a dial test is negative and varus stress is positive, in such scenario, yes, you can plan for a fibula sink procedure, either a Larsen procedure or a Arserio. It depends whether you want one single socket in the femur or two socket in the femur. I usually put one socket in femur because most of the time we deal with a very small femoral condyle, and putting two or three sockets in small femoral condyle is quite difficult. So this is the take home message. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rajiv. Very precise presentation. Now this is open for discussion. So modified Larsen, many people do this modified Larsen for dial as well as the varus, positive. And we had one guest faculty on the webinar. He also suggested that is good enough for your PLC. So, what Sanjay, do the other people feel about it?
Yeah, Sanjay, I have been doing only the modified Larsen for the last so many years. I have never done a
TBL.
Now, the two things I would like to just get it, Rajiv. First thing is that the fibular tunnel that you are making, this probably is not the best direction. The direction should be from anteromedial lower to posterolateral. I'm sorry, the other way, anterolateral to posteromedial.
Posteromedial, yes.
Correct.
And in the slope, yeah.
You have to go from anterolateral to posteromedial and from low to high, not from anterolateral to posteromedial the way you have shown, because it should not be transverse, it has to be oblique. Then the anterior limb, it sort of, goes along the anatomical direction of the fibulocollateral ligament. Mm-hmm. And the other part, in the Arciero, okay, I go deep to the biceps tendon, go through the capsule and come out on the lateral femoral condyle. So there are three things, why I don't like to do that is, A, I think there are three tunnels in the tibia. There are that many tunnels in the femur. Whenever, plus there is one additional graft. You may, of course, do it with a single semi-T graft also, a laparat, not that you can't do it. And you have an additional fixation again on the tibia. So in order to avoid that, and I've had very good results with the modified RCRO technique. The other thing is, if you really go to see, both the techniques are not really anatomical. There are a lot of other structures which contribute. But we know that these are the three main structures which contribute towards the posterolateral. Whenever you have an ACL, and we say that if you have a posterolateral, okay, you are going to stress if you do not address it. The posterolateral biomechanically, and this is Laprade's paper, that posterolateral, okay, for an ACL does not contribute towards ACL stress on the ACL graft. Yes, a lateral does. So if you have an LCL injury, then an LCL injury definitely increases the stress on your ACL graft. But a posterolateral does not increase the stress on your ACL graft. Do you understand? But definitely a PCL definitely increases, if there is a posterolateral, it increases the stress on the PCL graft. No question about it. So one little modification on the fibula, where you go a little bit from anterior lateral to posteromedial. And the other thing, of course, is either you can take single tunnel or two tunnels on the femur, because not every time you're able to take two tunnels, because I find that our lateral femoral condyles are much smaller than the American ones. So, sometimes I just use a single tunnel and try and put a screw in between, hoping that one part of the tendon goes, towards the epicondyle and the other goes more towards the popliteus tendon.
Yes, Dr. Larson has told.
Come again, Rajiv. Yes, we didn't get that.
Yeah, so modified Larson has told by Abhay sir, it's quite good because what Abhay sir is doing is rerouting it through the biceps. So it's like a posterolateral capsular tenodesis also, which is absolutely, which gives some amount absolutely of protective instability.
Not yeah only that, so, you have to also take the capsule. Yeah. You also open the capsule yeah posteriorly and you attach it to your the limb of the posterior limb, that is your popliteus yeah tendon limb.
So
that is where you attach it. So you are able to reach that posterior capsule also.
So some, as we told, explosive pivot, you have explosive posterolateral rotatory instability, like external rotation and recurvatum deformity with ACL, which is not very common with ACL. It is very common with PCL, yeah, external rotator recurvatum. In those condition, I think the Laprade technique or TBL technique will only work, and it's the fibulous procedure. The chances of failures are, or getting a graft laxity of the posterior graft is quite high.
See, as a matter of fact, if you look at literature, there is no comparative study between the two. Whatever comparative study is done is basically a biomechanical yes study, which is on cadavers. A clinical long-term comparative study between explosive so-called reverse pivot shift and an explosive posterolateral has not been done. It is our, as orthopedic surgeons, it is our thinking, or a tunnel, or a graft, or a tight kiya, to stability jada hoga. But we have really not done a good long-term comparative study. All the studies that are done are cadaveric. As a matter of fact, because I have just given this, I'll tell you, 2020, there is a, on Journal of Arthroscopy, there is a nice article. So they have done a robotic study of the RCRO. I mean, not only RCRO, it is done, as a matter of fact, a fibular sling procedure and Laprade's tibia-based procedure. And they have shown that there is basically over-constraint with the Laprade at 60 degrees of flexion. Whereas there is an under-constraint of the sling procedure at 90 degrees of flexion. Now, 90 degrees of flexion is not a position where you generally have too many activities done. And that is why even if you are a little less constrained at 90 degrees, it does not matter. Because 60 degrees, which is probably the most important, both of them are equal. So 30 degrees, 0 degree, 30 degrees, 60 degrees, they have not found. But this is again a cadaveric study, and it is a robotic study, using a robotic arm and everything else. So there are even computer-based studies, but there has not been any really good literature to tell you, comparative literature in clinical cases.
Yes, Atik, you wanted to...
Dr. Narvekar, do you feel in your experience that with the Laprade we are over-tightening?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, that is what the literature says, because I have not done Laprade, but the literature says that you tend to over-constrain. Now here, when you're doing an anterolateral, you are so concerned about over-constraint of the lateral compartment. You understand?
What about sports which require constraint beyond 90 degrees, let's say kabaddi or,
where the constraint is more than 90, there the Laprade is the procedure which is shown to provide good constraint. Whereas a fibular base does not provide that same degree. It does provide, but it is nowhere compared to what the Laprade provides. So I think we've got to rethink all the time as to which procedures to be provided to which patient.
Yeah.
Narveda sir, you never use TBL based, there is a PCL and PLC is there. And in a PLC, you see that sometimes we see on the MRI, popliteus is also averse or popliteus is not in place over there. Then you don't think TBL based will be a better than that?
No, basically I'll tell you what. This particular procedure, I would do a posterior capsule, as I told you, posterior capsule reefing attached to all the posterior structures as well as the graft. And the other problem over... Sorry. So I do not use that. If there is anything which is repairable, I would repair there. But whatever is in the chronic setting is not repairable, I would just do a fibula base, but RCRO, not the sling, not just anteroposteriorly on the fibula and taking it to a single portal. No,
Dr. I would not
do that. And the third thing is, you are doing a PCL. So the PCL itself also is going to provide you that degree of stability.
Yeah, Dr. Narvekar.
Is it the same procedure you spoke about, the posterior capsular shift?
Yes.
Yeah.
But
what is this?
Narserio, sir.
But there are two tunnels here.
Correct.
Narvekar probably does single tunnel.
No. Yeah. I do two tunnels where the condyle is big. And in case you are not going to have another tunnel of the ACL, like what Rajiv had shown. So if you're doing it with a PCL, you will have two tunnels. The only difference is that you are not doing an anterior-posterior tibial graft.
Okay.
If you look, and if you really look at the posterolateral anatomy, you know, I've done it a lot of dissections 20 years ago. Okay. The popliteofibular ligament is not attached to the bone. The popliteofibular fibular ligament is attached to the musculotendinous junction of the popliteus.
Popliteus.
And therefore, it is a dynamic stabilizer. It is not a passive stabilizer. So I really do not know how much this stabilizer contributes in 90 degrees of flexion, because at that point it is bound to be lax in a static way. And really, if you ask me, I do not find that the amount of stability that you're looking at vis-a-vis the number of tunnels that you're putting in the femur, the tibia, the graft that you're taking, because that always, you know, whether it is worth, and the time taken, because you're increasing the morbidity, you're increasing the time of surgery, you're probably doing it as a part of multi-ligament scenario. So I find this procedure to be fairly good, and it sort of saves about 15 minutes, 10, 15 minutes.
Yeah. Rajiv?
Yes, Raghuvir.
Sir, Rajiv, you said which angle you want to fix that Larson's procedure? You said it is 60 degrees flexion?
No, in Laparade is 60 to 70 degree. In Larson, you can do it 30 to 40 degree of flexion.
Yeah. But you have told me that in your talk it was 60 degrees. 60
degrees. Maybe it's a 30 to 40 degree.
But
the popliteal stability needs to be fixed at 60 degree only.
Yeah.
Popliteus at 30 degree. Yeah. Popliteus may not function at 30 degree, and it's a tenodesis effect. So tenodesis effect you can achieve only when you have a maximum rotation in the flexion. That will happen only at the 60 degree. Popliteus will work as popliteus will act as a sole internal rotator of the knee joint. I think that
basically Roshan, I agree on that, because FCL is 60 and popliteus at 60. This is the crux.
Yeah. Rajiv.
Like IS ka meeting.
Yes.
I am leaving.
Okay. Bye bye.
Yes,
Rajiv.
Yes.
Ranjit.
So is there some, what's your take on avoiding tunnel confluence in cases of multi ligament injuries like ACL with PLC? And then do you have some technique of avoiding tunnel confluence? Hello?
Technique of tunnel confluence.
I think your voice is not clear. I can't hear. Yeah, Vinay. You can just
doctor.
Yeah.
So, what's your take on doing method of avoiding tunnel confluence in cases of doing multi-leg surgeries like ACL with PLC or
so if you go for anatomical ACL, you are quite low, so you don't worry. But if the patient, you are dealing with a revision ACL, so at the level of lateral epicondyle only, you will have, you may have your femoral tunnel for a transtable, when it is done by transtable technique, but it's a high up. So in those scenario only, I prefer single socket, because don't want to do a tunnel coalesce. Again, the second point is that you don't want your graft or your build to go through the intercondylar knot. Try to follow the superior pole of the patella. You build, try to build towards the superior pole of the patella so that you can avoid the intercondylar knot. Yes, Ranjit.
Rajiv, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Short stature athletes with small knees, okay, where there is a dial is positive. So what do you do? How you manage your femoral tunnels?
As I told you, if you are going for anatomical ACL, your ACL tunnel is quite low. But if you are planning for a tibial based femoral socket, make single socket. I think that putting two sockets there is every chance of mergence of or coalesce of merging of your tunnels also. So try to make a single socket.
But in athletes,
Ranjit, you are not audible.
I think you have lost Ranjit in there.
He was trying to ask was what happens in athletes when you need to, you know, but I guess if the condyle is small, you have to go with the small tunnel.
So as I have been doing this single femoral socket for my both for the fibular sling procedure and for tibial sling procedure. I think it has worked. Roshan, what is your take on single femoral socket? Or Abhay sir? Yeah. Samir is there, I think. Roshan is there. Samir, what is your take on whether you follow two femoral socket or single femoral socket?
I have never made two femoral sockets ever, yeah. Actually.
Same here, single femoral socket.
Femoral socket. I think it has. It works. Even yes. In athlete, it works.
In Indian scenario, when the femur condyle is so small, sometimes
most of our condyles are so small.
Yes.
Even Laprade's original technique is not 100% reproduction of whatever God has given to us. So you have to, and these patients are not going to go back to the excellent previous level of their sporting. They need to feel stable, and return to sports is not actually, you know, that great.
If we don't have any questions, can we go on to Ranjit
for a
case? Yes.
Can you share your screen? Yeah, go ahead. Ranjit, meanwhile, share your screen.
So, do you fix your fibular graft in the fibular tunnel with maybe some anchor or maybe
No. What I do, I usually with the vicryl, I usually suture it with the soft tissue around the tunnel. So in Indian fibula, it's very difficult to put a screw there, even 6 millimeter screw.
Don't try there.
You
anchors, an anchor? No.
No anchor. Only an anchor also. Try to tie it with some soft tissue along the tunnel.
Okay, so no that will.
No.
I think we'll have a nice case discussion. We have another half an hour. Ranjit, can you proceed?
Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity. I think most of the things have been discussed by Samir because most of the cases Roshan told me to include MCL as far as practicable. So we will go through the cases, one or two cases. The case one is a 25-year male with history of twist injury of left knee 3 weeks back while playing cricket, following which he was advised rest and medication. And
Ranjit, make a slide slow, please.
Okay. Is it okay?
Yes.
It's okay now.
So he was on conservative treatment for 3 weeks, and after 2 weeks, he was mobilized also. But when he presented, he is complaining of instability of the left knee while walking without support. On examination, there was medial joint line tenderness, and the tenderness was more on the femoral side also. The range of movement was good. It was 0 to 120 degree. The valgus stress test was positive. It was grade 3 at 30 degree of flexion, and grade 2 in 0 degree of flexion. Anterodroid test was positive, Lachman was positive, pivot shift was positive, and anteromedial rotatory instability, that is slocum drawer, was positive, was present. Now the X-ray was almost normal, and these are her important MRI slides, which shows a complete tear in ACL and there is an MCL tear. Now my question, at 3 weeks, what is the opinion of the panel, how they will proceed? Dr. Rajiv?
Did you get some stress X-ray?
I didn't do stress X-ray in this patient because it is only 3 weeks old and the patient was having some degree of pain also. But I didn't do the stress X-ray in this case.
So, Ranjit, what is the grade of MCL injury right now at 3 weeks?
Grade 3
MCL with ACL.
So Ranjit, this is the femoral side injury, grade 3 injury.
Yes.
Femoral side injury, patient has come to you at 3 weeks. And in full extension, there is opening?
Yes, grade 2 positive, and at 30 degree flexion, grade 3 positive. There is opening at 30 degree and 0 degree.
Right.
So, Rajiv, what is your take? How will you proceed?
So, it's a ACL tear, complete ACL tear with grade 3 MCL tear. And so, I will go for a ACL reconstruction with a plan for MCL repair and augmentation. Because at 3 weeks, most of the time I don't go for isolated repair only. I repair it and I augment it with a semi-T or gracilis graft.
Okay, that is single stage?
Single stage, yes, yes. Gate 3, I do it in single stage.
Okay. Will you go for the anatomical reconstruction or on the medial side?
Yeah,
or
I will
repair with augmentation.
I will repair with augmentation.
Okay. Samir, can you hear me? Hello.
Yeah, Ranjit. Like it's a 3 week time. So I will give some more time for this patient for rehab. I would wait for 6 weeks at least for this patient, 6 weeks to yeah. And then I would decide for reconstruction along with ACL reconstruction.
Okay.
After 6 weeks, if patient is coming back to you, he is having a MCL grade 3 along with ACL is there. One stage you can go ahead and do a ACL reconstruction plus MCL reconstruction for that. At present, you can give a hinge knee brace and wait for MCL to heal because it's a femoral sided tear. And literature also supports that like chances of healing are much more on the femoral side.
Okay, but right now at 3 weeks also the patient is having grade 3 opening at 30 degree flexion, grade 2 opening at 0 degree flexion. He has some degree of anteromedial instability also. So, do you continue with this, the conservative treatment? Are you expecting a good result after 3 weeks? No?
Yeah, like I believe in doing a reconstruction now. So, it's better for me to wait for 6 weeks and then do a reconstruction instead of doing now.
Okay, Dr. Atik.
Yeah, it's a femoral side. Yeah, I would do an ACL reconstruction with repair because being on the femoral side, I think chances of healing are high. So I would probably repair and augment. Same sitting.
Right now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Narbega, there is a possibility that there might be a sleeve avulsion from the femoral side.
Obviously, I'll wait for his movements to come back. That is swelling, etc. subside. I won't be in a hurry to go ahead and repair or reconstruct the MCL at this point. Probably do exactly what Sabir said. I would see him under anesthesia, open up and see how much he opens on the medial side, put in a scope. Scope will tell me how much it opens on the medial side, and then I'll take a call whether just an ACL or maybe ACL with whatever required, depending upon what I find on table. But definitely nothing at this point. I'll wait till he gets his movements back. This
Ranjit,
because I'll tell you 2-3 things. If you look at the MRI, even at 3 weeks, there doesn't seem to be much of bone edema. So velocity of injury doesn't seem to be that high. Number two, the avulsion is from the femoral side. Again, that is, as everybody said, it can heal. And if it is going to heal, then I don't want to disturb there. And somehow I always find that whenever you do something on the femoral side in such cases, okay, they go on complaining of pain on the femoral side. So if you repair these, they go on complaining of pain on that femoral side. Probably the superior genicular nerve is close by or what, I don't know. But they go on, after that, they will only go on covering your pain where you have put in your whatever attachment.
I think we have lost Ranjit. Ranjit, can you hear us?
Ranjit, network issue is there, I think.
Ranjit, I think your MRI and your clinical picture is not in the sync. Such MRI, usually femoral, injuries, they usually heal very well in 4 to 6 weeks time of conservative treatment, and then you can very peacefully do only ACL reconstruction. So I think at 3 weeks there is no point in going for augmentation or attempt to repair and all.
Ranjit,
you'll end up with more stiffness.
Ranjit, in these cases of three weeks of injury, do you get this orthoscanogram for these cases? Hello?
Orthoscanogram, I thought.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. Did you get this orthoscanogram for these cases which are like 3 weeks, 4 weeks old to plan your judgment of surgery? What kind of surgery you will do?
If his age is little bit more, then I would have gone for this orthoscanogram. But he is hardly 24, 25 years young male. So I didn't go for orthoscanogram. What is the opinion of panel in young individuals also, we should go for orthoscanogram?
So I feel if it's a varus knee, we can be getting away with doing little conservative kind of procedure. But it's a valgus knee, 3 weeks old, some reconstruction has to be done. It's a, like
knee alignment. Absolutely, it was looking fine. There was no component, but I didn't do any arthroscanogram in this.
Yeah, if I am concerned about alignment, I go for arthroscanogram. It's not like a routine, but in revision, yes, that is my first.
Ranjit, I have a question. Whether your knee is unstable in 0 degree of flexion, that is extension,
and
30 degree. What is the grade in 0 degree and 30 degree?
Grade in 0 degree is 2+. Grade in 30 degree is 3+. The knee is quite unstable. The patient is complaining. Yeah. The patient is insisting that I am having serious problems.
No. See,
can we do? What is patient's version?
No. That is very important, because if there is an instability in 0 degree or 30 degree of flexion, that means there is something which is needs to be taken care of. It's a very, very unstable knee. Probably the MCL is a central pivot of the knee joint. And once you lose that central pivot and medial stabilizing structure, it is bound to be a very greatly unstable knee joint. So I think at this level, I will offer her directly, since it has been already given a trial of conservative lineup management. See, the same scenario with grade 2 or grade 2 instability in extension and grade 3 instability in flexion, I would have offered a conservative lineup management. But it is a grade 3 instability in flexion, 0 degree of extension. That means POR is completely gone and MCL is completely gone. When it is grade 3, I will offer a surgery in the form of MCL and POL repair, SOS augmentation, as Dr. Raman has said, Rajiv Raman has said. And then if required, a ACL reconstruction at the same time, or I can stage it, depending. Since she is a female patient, I would like to stage the ACL, because sometimes you may not require an ACL in female patients. So I will do only MCL repair, primary repair.
But Roshan, don't you think this MRI picture and the clinical findings are clinical, not really matching?
Yeah, clinical finding and MRI picture is really not matching.
I also in that impression seeing this MRI, because he sent me this MRI in WhatsApp. So I also thought in that line. So I told him that you may be requiring only one ligament reconstruction, and we can do it any time in 3 weeks time. So you come leisurely. But clinically, what I saw, then it was there was significant instability at.
Did you examine opposite knee? And see, it is very important to quantify the instability by stress
x-ray. I examined opposite knee by pain.
So if you see this quantification of test, which we are doing it, and I'll just show you one test which. MCL, I think you can see here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, we can see.
Yeah. So the instability in extension and instability in flexion. So this kind of MCL injury with 100% will require
surgery.
Surgery. So I don't know whether your picture is similarly like this or something else.
No, the 30 degree, it was similar, but zero degree is a little bit less than 30 degree, okay. But it is opening up.
Okay. So, and as Dr. Abhay Narvekar was saying that he'd like to do an arthroscopy and see. Similarly, you can see the arthroscopic picture. Sometimes you'll see the complete invagination of the medial collateral ligament. I'll just show you here. You can see here, this is the ACL tear. Can you see the ACL tear? Mm-hmm. Now, once you see the ACL, you can see this patient.
But, yeah, Steiner lesions are like this, but in MRI, they are evident actually.
Yeah. So, this is the arthroscopic when you see the ACL, PCL. And if you see the MCL, you can see the below the meniscus.
Yes, so sometimes
you will see the invagination of the tibial ligament, which has gone inside the tibiofemoral joint
below the meniscus.
So if you have this kind of lesion, then you'll need surgery. In your case, it is something else. So it is not matching the, as Dr. Sanjay was saying, it is not matching the level of
clinical picture versus the MRI.
MRI.
Yeah.
Yes. So exactly, I thought in that way. I planned for the simultaneously dealing with the MCL. I planned for the surgery. So I told the patient, if at all the surgery is required for you, then we'll go for MCL surgery.
So did you operate or you didn't operate?
I have operated already.
Operation.
Yeah. He will show. Yeah.
Yeah.
खाके हजम कर दिया.
You can share your screen ना रंजीत. ये
हाँ रंजीत, share the screen.
Not coming.
No, it's not there.
No, it's not there. It's not.
Okay. It has been unshared.
So what was the clinical intraop finding, Ranjit? Intraop picture?
Yes, the intraop picture. Then I went inside the knee. Then I had the same impression. Like you, and the ACL was completely torn, as is evident in the MRI, and the medial there is drive-through sign is quite evident, and the opening up was quite big, so that I decided for the MCL surgery at that point of time.
Okay, just let us know what you have done.
Okay.
Just make it full screen PPT.
Clinical video was there.
Yeah.
Okay, I did the ACL reconstruction. Then I planned for MCL reconstruction anatomical, because I was getting under anesthesia. The grade three valgus in 30 degree of flexion, and almost grade three at 0 degree of flexion. The rotatory instability was quite significant. So I thought, simply by doing ACL, it will not solve the problems. So I decided for the reconstruction of the MCL. So on the medial side, I liberal incision. And then of MCL by semi to ipsilateral, as we were discussing, and that Sami was asking. So I also do the MCL reconstruction taking the ipsilateral semi T. So the semi T was attached to its distal insertion, and then I re-rooted the semi T. So I went for three windows. The first window is here, where I incise the face and expose the semi-T. And the second window is near the femoral tunnel, but I could see there is a complete tear of this MCL near the femoral insertion site. And then the third window is at the level of the joint line, you will be seeing. So first I went for the this identification of the isometric point, or the attachment of the superficial MCL on the distal tibia, that is 6 cm from the joint line. And deflecting the face, I can mark this point. And then I put an anchor over that point, that is posterior to the face and anterior to the posterior medial border of the tibia. And then I fixed this semi-T over that anchor for the distal insertion point of this MCL. And this is the fixation of the semi-T on the distal part. Then I harvested the semi-T with the open stripper. And on the femoral side, I planned for only one tunnel. So posterior and proximal to the medial epicondyle, I passed the guide wire and created a tunnel of 25 to 30 millimeter on the femoral side. And I looped the semi-T and created the loop, which will be going through the femoral tunnel. And I fixed the femoral tunnel at that point. And for the attachment of SMCL on the proximal tibia, that is 1 cm distal to the joint line, I put another anchor and fix this MCL, SMCL at that point. And then I created the third window here and went for the creation of POL tunnel. So I rerouted the tendon under the fascia. And then I loaded the leading sutures through the POL tunnel and fixed tendon in the POL tunnel. That is just proximal to the semimembranous insertion. And then I closed all the windows and the knee was quite stable at 30 degree and 0 degree of extension after the surgery. Because after doing ACL reconstruction also, the knee was opening up at 0 degree of flexion or 0 degree of extension. And that is why I planned this anatomical reconstruction of the MCL. But I did only one femoral tunnel and I kept the attachment of the semi-T as it is on the tibial side. So this is the process done. Then we go to the second case. Any discussion after this? Hello? Hello?
You are audible.
Yes, Ranjit, you had satisfactory outcome. So, yeah, what is the end result now?
The patient is 3 months post now, and his knees are quite stable. The range of movement was 0 to 120 degrees, and he is walking comfortably. And right now, the instability is almost no. So in this case, my query is, should we go for the conservative treatment a little more, or should we repair and augment, or should we reconstruct at 3 weeks post injury?
Hello.
So should we go with the clinical findings or only with the radiological finding? Because in this there is a quite discrepancy in the radiology MRI and
I think MCL more of clinical decision making is more important than the radiology, because sometimes you might see the radiological lesion, but clinically the instability may not be proportionate to what you see on MRI. But I think the clinical examination will give you more and more understanding about the lesion rather than the radiology.
Okay. Can we go to the second case?
Yeah.
One question to Roshan, Abhay sir, and Nicholas sir. So, how often do you go for this stress view? Because we have been doing this reconstruction with the clinical examination and radiological finding. So how often you go for a stress view when you are suspecting a medial injury or a lateral corner injury?
I think your CM is always in the OT. You can always just check under CM.
It's better to go for a stress view before.
Yes. Always better.
Always
better. See, quantitative analysis of MCL lesion is only on radiological.
Yeah. So that is after Laplace.
You can't decide grade 2, grade 3 on just clinical examination. You have to test it under CM or X-ray, stress X-ray, and then only you can decide whether it's a grade 3 or grade 2. So if you want a rationalized approach, better to do a clinical examination under CM.
Yeah. And scanogram in these individuals are required, you do routinely.
I think these people are not able to stand also. How can you do a scanogram? See, a scanogram is indicated when you are checking for alignment. But if he is not able to stand on single leg, I don't think so. Scanogram is that important because it's an unstable knee. So I think primary concern is not alignment. Primary concern is ligament instability.
You are not trying to see the joint space also in a long neck.
Yes.
Here you want to see the ligamentous instability, which will better seen in a stress view. Right?
Yes. Stress view is more important than scanogram.
Then scanogram. Okay, the second case.
Yeah.
45-year male had a history of road traffic accident 2 months back. Was treated conservatively with spleen, rest and medications. Now presented with symptoms of pain and instability while walking unaided without spleen. Now on examination, there was no joint line tenderness as such. The range of movement was 0 to 110 degree. The posterior sag sign was positive. There was complete loss of tibial step off. The anterodroid test was positive from neutral position. The posterodroid test was positive. The valgus stress test was positive. It was grade 3 at 30 degree and 0 degree. The dial was negative. Genu recurvatum external rotation was negative. There was no distal neurovascular deficiency. Now, these are the X-ray. The right hand side in neutral position with varus stress, the middle one, and the with valgus stress, the left hand side one. So there is quite a significant opening on the medial side. And with posterior stress X-ray, the posterior translation is also quite significant. We compared with the opposite side and from the neutral position. I'm not having that posterior stress X-ray comparison view. And these are the X-ray I am having right now. So, so how will you proceed for this case? Dr. Raghubir? Raghubir, sir?
Raghubir, are you there, Raghubir? We have many people. Dr. Siddharth Agarwal, Raghuveer, Rajiv Raman, Samir Sheikh, Vinay Pandey, Vinay, Nicholas Santao, Siddharth, Atik Vasudev. Please opine on this case, Vinay. Vinay, can you hear me, Dr. Vinay Pandey?
So, we have a question. How old is this injury, Dr. Sanjeev?
2 months old
MCL. This is MCL plus ACL or MCL plus PCL?
MCL, ACL, PCL.
MCL, ACL, PCL. Okay, that's great. So, it's, so it comes in multi ligament injury.
Multi yeah, ligament.
Absolutely. So for me,
was there any dislocation which was reduced?
No dislocation history. As per the patient's own version, he told me that after the accident, he was taken to the hospital. And in the hospital, there was no deformity as such after the incidents. And in the hospital, they immediately put him on a slab for 2 weeks. And then after removing the slab, he had stiffness. Then he was put on a knee brace. Then gradually he went to a physio and gradually he mobilized. That means probably he did not have any dislocation in this case.
Yeah, so it is 2 months after the injury.
2 months
so, after the collateral goes first. So I'll take the ipsilateral hamstring tendon for reconstructing the medial corner. And once the range is good.
From here, what else you want to do? Now you are having these X-rays and these stress views.
So it is 2 months, good range of motion. Patient has got good range of motion. Then we're going to start with the reconstruction of the structures. So I'll start with the collateral first, medial side, with the ipsilateral hamstring tendons. And go with the rehabilitation.
One second. You don't like to see any MRI or tissue assessment or any scanogram?
Yes, obviously. Yes. Yeah. No scanogram.
You told him the diagnosis ACL, PCL plus MCL. So he started surgery.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, we will move on to the next investigation. This was his scanogram. There was no limb malalignment. And these were his MRI pictures. The sagittal views, the complete rupture of ACL and PCL, almost complete rupture with some remnant preserved. And there is MCL injury also.
Okay, so grade 3 ACL, MCL and PCL. Right.
Yes.
Okay, before going, Ranjit, so what's the technique of doing this posture? Sometimes this kneeling posture stress view is done for PCL injuries. So you do that, or it's like
I do like that kneeling.
Which one is this kneeling stress view or this normal?
Yeah, kneeling stress view. Or else I put a just box kind of thing, and then the patient stands and squats over that box. so that we can see the posterior translation. There are two ways of doing that.
Okay.
Or else some radiologists, they put the limb on the crutch, the axillary crutch, and put one weight. So in that way, they are doing this posterior stress views.
So sir, the diagnosis is clear. It's like MCL injury with a PCL injury as an ACL injury.
I just wanted to know here, Ranjit, there is a looks like a meniscus extrusion. Was there any root or ramp lesion?
No. Arthroscopically, I will show you the arthroscopic view.
Okay.
There was absolutely nothing.
Even after 2 months, Ranjit, it looks like there are bruises. You can see.
These are fresh MRIs or after 2 months?
No. This is not the fresh MRI. After removing the slab, they have taken the MRI. Probably after 10 to 15 days after removing the slab, when they put them on the knee brace, they took that MRI.
Normally, we get these bruises after 3 up to 6 months also.
We get that.
It's written over here, Nightingale Hospital.
Yes, he got it from Calcutta. Calcutta patient went to Ranjit. See,
तुम बराबर present नहीं करता ना MCL cases. They know Ranjit presents MCL cases, so went to Ranjit. So what did you do, Ranjit?
What is your
my opinion?
Ranjit.
My opinion is all three at one go
together.
Yeah, Ranjit, even I will do all three PCL, together. MCL as well as ACL in one stage and start rehab as early as possible. Only thing is that if PCL along with MCL when we are doing, the anyway femoral condyle, it is a not, you will accommodate single bundle for PCL, single bundle for PCL, and MCL here it's a grade 3. So again, I will take only one tunnel for the MCL, not anatomical apparatus type.
Okay.
Same thing, all three together. And I agree with Samir, single tunnels.
Okay. So let's see. This was the clinical picture. This is the posterior drawer, quite evident. Grade 3. Anterior drawer. And this is the MCL opening. Okay, so ACM was available, so intra-op, again I checked the medial opening up. So it was quite significant opening because ACL, PCL both gone, so that's why the opening is more, I think. And the intratransverse, hello?
Yeah, we lost you.
Yeah, we can listen. We can listen.
Screen sharing.
Can listen to you, screen sharing. Tomorrow is Dr. Lars Engbergsten's meeting. So I have put it on the arthroscopy study group. Yeah. So he's going to speak on multi-ligament repair in Olympic athletes. We have to prepare for Olympic now. No? Modi, Prime Minister Modi is bidding for Olympic. 2-3-2 Olympics. So we have to be ready for Olympics.
Okay, it's visible now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So the anterior translation was more than the posterior translation. It was intra-op. Then this is the scopy finding. So some remnant of PCL was there. And ACL was completely gone. So meniscus was in position, but there is significant opening up of medial compartment, as we'll see now. So as you go on putting varus stress, there is significant opening on the medial. So I took the peroneus tendon graft and contralateral semiti. So peroneus for the PCL and contralateral semite for the ACL and the ipsilateral semite rerouting again for the MCL. So we can do it anatomical reconstruction by but in this case I went for all inside sockets because it's a multi-ligament injury. So we reconstructed the PCL by all inside technique and ACL by all inside technique. First we went for PSN of the femoral tunnel. And then the PSN of the tibial tunnel. For the PCL and LCL. And simultaneously we were passing the leading sutures in all the sockets. So first the PCL was passed from the intramedial portal into the joint and then into the tibial tunnel. The keeping one within the rod and it is just passing into the tibial tunnel. So the graft link for PCL is passing into the tibial tunnel and then we pass it into the femoral tunnel. All the remnants were preserved. So I always do remnant preserving surgery for PCL and I always do single tunnel. So on the PCL side, the femoral side, it was fixed by toggling movement. Once you toggle, then your mark will go exactly to that point. And then we went for all inside ACL, all inside ACL semite grafting was created for ACL. Then we toggle on the femoral side, and then on the tibial side. So you can see the graft is passing into the femoral side, and then into the tibial side. So you should see very well when it is passing through the tibial tunnel. It is very important for all inside. First, keeping in the entire drawer, we fix the central pivot, the PCL. And without fixing the ACL tibial side, we went for MCL reconstruction. So again the same technique, not exactly same. In this case, I didn't go for POL tunnels. I went for single tunnel on the femur. And from the tibial side, it was rerouted. So with 30 degree of flexion, with varus stress, was fixed and SMCL was fixed on the proximal part of the tibia again. The second intersocial. And then finally, we tightened the ACL all inside ACL. So this is the final picture after the reconstruction. The knee is quite stable. Both the ligaments are quite anatomically placed. And postoperatively at 0 degree and 30 degree, the knee is quite stable.
Ranjit, what's your post operative protocol for this?
Post operative protocol in this case, I start knee range of movement as early as possible. I keep one posterior tibial support. I keep one, I have created on the knee brace a elevation kind of thing, ready made. So I keep that and keep elevated the posterior part of the tibia like we do in the PCL. And while doing the knee movement, first I do prone knee movements. And gradually after 3 weeks, I start active knee movement. At 6 to 8 weeks, I start gradual weight bearing. And by 3 months, full weight bearing. And then strengthening exercises. And by 6 months, all the activities.
Okay, any question?
Yeah, so you get range of motion, try to get ROM in prone position or in supine position in these patients?
Prone position. When I am going for a supine position, I ask my physio to hold the upper part of the tibia when he is doing the flexion. If the physio is not there and if the patient is doing at home, then I advise the prone position knee flexion initially.
See, how many of you use the hinge knee braces? Hinge knee brace,
Hinge knee braces, after 6 weeks when we mobilize the patient, because he is not interested to keep the knee brace 24 hours. So when we mobilize the patient, then I switch over to the hinge knee brace or limited motion knee brace after 6 weeks. And during resting times, he puts on the static knee brace, always.
Ranjit, seems to be a case of dislocation because ACL, PCL, multi-leg injury.
But as per history, nothing was there. He didn't tell me, I categorically asked him that the knee was dislocated, it has gone posteriorly. Someone pulled your knee to make it set. He told no, sir.
So I was just curious.
But I was not moving, I was not able to move the knee and it was very painful. I could not do anything. And I kept the knee as it is, and they put the plaster immediately after that. And then after 3 weeks, he went to the second surgeon where they removed the plaster, and then the physio, whatever he has advised. And after 2 months, he came to me.
No, I was just asking, any specific reason for posterior oblique ligament not to be reconstructed in this case? We had multiple injury.
I'll tell you the scenario. The POL reconstruction is only done in western part. The European people and the Americans, they use POL. If you go to the Japanese and Korean surgeons, they don't believe in POL. They will do only the central MCL reconstruction. In fact, they say that MCL is a very flat structure. So these are the two different concepts altogether for MCL reconstruction, because I have seen the Dr. Kurosaka from Japan as well as Kobe University, Dr. Raiso Kuroda. They all reconstruct only the superficial MCL. The Jin Gu Kim team from Korea, as well as Jinja Chao and Zhao and Feng Hua, the one who died recently. They all do only central superficial MCL reconstruction. They never believed in POL.
But Roshan, they reef the POL usually.
Yeah, but they don't reconstruct.
Yeah, they do the reefing of POL.
Yeah, so I think that is a very different concept altogether. In here also, I think the Lind technique is more appropriate than the Robert Laparat technique. See, creating two tunnels on the femoral side, then that to another tunnel for PCL. And if you're doing double bundle like Samir does double bundle PCL, then it becomes four tunnel on the femoral medial femoral condyle.
Not for such cases. but always, this is the scenario when PCL, MCL is there.
I still remember I did one live surgery. Dr. Gopi is there on the panel. I did one live Gopi surgery. I did one live surgery in IAS Calicut. And there it was the Laparat technique plus ACL plus PCL. So on lateral side, there was a ACL tunnel, the Laparat 2 tunnel, 3 tunnel, and that patient was very small. So I was feeling very bad about it. I said, abhi toh itna sa hi bone bacha hai, it can fracture anytime. So I think one has to understand that our femurs, Dr. Abhay Narvekar has said, our femurs are not same as what Dr. Laparat is
very small.
Seeing. You know,
very, 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 very small. That's true.
Yeah. So in small tunnels, small femur, if you try to make 3-4 tunnels, then it is very difficult to manage.
Ranjit,
yes,
you can mobilize